Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Dance On. I'm Nancy Umanoff, the Executive Director of the Mark Morris Dance Group. I've had the pleasure of attending more than 100 premieres of Mark's work over the years, but none quite like this. Mark's work and our extraordinary dancers and musicians would have been seen across the country this spring, but instead we find ourselves here on the Zoom stage. But it is truly heartening to see how many guests, how many friends and fans are joining us tonight on both YouTube and Zoom. We are up to nearly 3,000 so far. That might be the all-time high for a Mark Morris premiere. And many of you have supported us over the years, following our performances, our classes, community ed programs, and Dance for Parkinson's. Without your support, we would not be here today. And so a heartfelt thank you from all of our staff, our artists, and our board, to all of you, and to the many individuals and institutions that have made contributions to our Dance On Recovery Fund. And a special thank you to our official sponsor, Bloomberg Philanthropies. And before we get started, just a few tips. It's probably best for you to watch this in full screen mode on a computer or laptop, rather than a tablet or phone, which will still work. I also encourage those of you who are watching on Zoom to use the Q&A function down on your toolbar, because Colin Fowler, our music director, and Mark will be here a little bit later to answer your questions. So now, let's get this underway, and please welcome Mark Morris.
Hello. It is I, Mark Morris. Thank you, Nancy. All, by the way, none of this would happen without Nancy because she is a miracle. Enough said, all the thanks. This show is not, what's a show? But this show is not about the novel coronavirus. It is by necessity, the backdrop to the whole thing. And it's the reason we're doing this like this, obviously. So I'm not gonna go into my woes and fears and traumas and stuff, but I will just tell you that dancers need two things, and one is space, and the other one is time, just like everybody else. So what we've got plenty of is time, and what we have much less of is space. If you've ever gone crazy dancing around your apartment, let's just say it's easier to sing in the shower than it is to dance in your apartment, no matter how palatial it might be. Anyway, so in while we can't perform, all theaters are shut, in case you haven't noticed that, we're working from home. My job isn't, well, it's not usually all in my apartment. A lot of my life is in my apartment. I live alone, I love that. But the rest of the time I'm at the building at the Mark Morris Dance Center working with my fabulous company of dancers and musicians. So first of all, thanks to everybody. It's been crazy to figure all of this out. And we've done a job that is, well, it's, you're gonna see it. So the first dance we're going to do in a second is called Lonely Waltz. And it is composed of phrases, actions, scenes that I've been choreographing for a while because I was planning to present this piece this summer at Tanglewood as a premiere celebrating the 1920s. Get it? 2020, 1920. So I chose Ravel's La Valse, a fabulous piece written for orchestra, but I like the arrangement for two pianos. So that's what I've done. And somehow Colin Fowler, my music director and pianist and conductor and editor in this case, is somehow playing two pianos, go figure. The dancers are executing, and I mean that, the phrases that we put together from this dance that was already in production, and we adapted it to our new situation. So I would like to watch Lonely Waltz. So please roll that and I'll come back after.
Thank you.
Okay, well, that was short. It was meant to be. I would now like to bring on to the screen music director, keyboardist, editor, friend, Colin Fowler. Colin? Oh, you're there.
Hi, Mark. I'm right here.
Hello there.
How are you?
I'm fine. I have a little anxiety, but you know, I'm okay. It's going fine, I guess, so far, but we just started.
What about? It's true. It's early yet.
Excuse me? It is early yet. Question. I don't know if that worked, but you know what I was watching was happening. And what horrible problems did we have trying to put this together besides the obvious one, like the plague? Anything?
Well, that was definitely an issue.
Do you not hear me?
It wouldn't have happened. I can hear you just fine. Can you hear me?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, can you hear me? I'm sorry.
Yes, yeah. I can. We're fine.
I think you can hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Yes. Wow. That's amazing. Just a second. That is fabulous.
What's fabulous?
Well, I'm back in a second here.
Okay. Well, to answer
here
your question.
I am.
Okay. Welcome back. To answer your question about. The horror show of that was, it was actually probably the least horror show of all the process because it started the most normal way. It started in the studio, making it up on actual people in an actual room together, and then was adapted for this process. That's also why this was the first of these projects that we started to do. And basically met on Zoom and had you figure out what can people do in their space, what can people do alone without partnering anybody.
Right.
So there were the horror shows are later.
Oh, that's great. Okay. Coming up next.
Yep.
Which I'm gonna talk about for a second. Yeah. I'm talking over you a lot. That's kind of weird, but that's okay. I choreographed a piece years and years ago for, believe it or not, Sesame Street, and I made up a dance for me and three able-bodied giant Muppets. So I used a piece, because I think children should know about this, called Anger Dance. And it's to a piece of music by the fabulous American composer Henry Cowell. And the story is, I may get it wrong, forgive me if I get some of the details wrong, but he was diagnosed with a horrible broken leg. His doctor said that probably the only solution was amputation, which seems a little extreme to me, but it was a long time ago. And he went home after this misdiagnosis, thank God it turned out to be that, and wrote a piece of music to play out his fury and disappointment and anger. And he called it Anger Dance, and it's in segments that can be repeated as many times as you want, as violently as you want, to get it out of your system, I think. So I took that piece, and this film dance, this video dance assignment has to do with the tone of the piece, the anger of the piece, and I think that's it. Why don't we just roll this dance, Anger Dance.
Thank you.
That burns me up. Oh, anyway,
you don't feel
hooray.
Better? You didn't get it out of your system? Come on.
I feel a lot better. I feel a lot better.
Good.
I have to tell you, my first dance, it was pretty jumpy to look at, the first one. And then I disappeared for a minute because for some reason, some old Hawaiian music came onto my headphones, and I can't explain that. But I'm sorry, it's Zoom, everybody. I'm so zoomed out. I can't believe it. Yeah.
Anger Dance streamed much better on my end than the
yeah.
answer one.
And well. I don't know. We all have different equipment. Anyhow, good. And now I should like to re-bring Nancy Umanoff back because we're going to take some questions now. I hope that's okay.
Yep, that's great. We actually do have quite a bit to bring to you guys. The first question is about what the process was. Did you first select the dancers for Anger Dance, or did you make the casting decisions in the editing room?
Well, on all of these pieces, I gave instructions to people, played the music. They all worked on it in their homes. Colin will expound on that. But then they submitted material, and we took it from there. It wasn't like an audition exactly, but it had to do with the material that we thought would somehow work together, Colin.
Yes, it's sort of an extrapolation of what happens in the studio where Mark has an idea, he'll show a move, give a direction, and there's 18 dancers in the room, and they take his information and do whatever with it, and then he'll say, I like that, and I like that, do that like that, do this like that. And then, you know, 3 months later, you have a dance. So that's similar to this in that the assignment was given to all, we get all the videos. Like, for instance, on Anger Dance, we got 85 different videos from the 18 members of the Mark Morris Dance Group. And so then Mark and myself and Sam Black, the rehearsal director, all meet on 2 to 5 hour Zoom meetings, go through and watch all the videos. We watch them alone. We watch them together. We make notes on a very extensive spreadsheet of sections we like, things that might go together, things that might be edited together nicely, or things that, that's not gonna work as well. And then I put together a first draft after that meeting. We have another meeting, we all look at it. We edit in real time over Zoom. I wanna try this there, move this dancer there. I don't like that as much. This edit doesn't work. We fix it. We do that 2 to 4 times, and then we have a video dance.
Yeah, that's it. That's the answer. Another question?
Certainly. Mark, we would like to know, if we can't gather in theaters for some time, do you think you would do a live stream performance with live music and live dancing?
I think probably that's inevitable. You know, obviously Zoom wasn't invented for what we're doing. We're adapting to it as we can. You know, things aren't ever going to be as they once were. You know, as everybody knows, there's no good old days if you really look at it. So we're looking at, I think, quite a big transformation. And of course, I'm not doing the job I normally do. And I'm working on adapting to this. But I think probably we'll do, I don't think that this, the sort of video communication part of it is going to go away. Not just the people who are lucky enough to be able to work from home, but also there's certainly a trepidation in getting close together. I walk big circles around people on the street because I'm so freaked out and scared. But I think probably it will become a natural implement, like it is if you're under 11. You know how to do this stuff so fabulously, and it is we older people who are slower to catch on. So I think it's around for forever. Another?
Okay, another comment. Anger Dance seems much like performance art. I've not seen your company go in that direction. Do you expect to go in that direction in the future?
Performance art. Well, dance is a performance art. Done. I would liken this more to cinema. That's why I call them video dances. It's not, as soon as it's on a screen, as far as I'm concerned, it's not just a dance anymore. It's a film of a dance. You know, we're missing a lot of dimensions and time things and anesthesia and, you know, dimensionality. So, you know, we're used to working in a big cube, and now we're working on a flat plane with a triangle behind it. I also find that communication, which I'm learning, especially from everybody wearing masks, is done with your eyes and your face. And so that's why a lot of this stuff turns into IE and facey, because people used to communicate like that more. So I think that's part of it. And you have to work more intimately on a screen. But, you know, I'm still basing all of this work on music. And if it's performance art, you know, so is opera, so is, you know, so are plays, and so is whatever performance art is. It's a big category as far as I'm concerned. The lyric arts, I would say.
Yeah, I'd also say that of your over 150 dances, this is not high English here, but some are more dancey than others. Some are more, I wouldn't say performance art necessarily, but some are more balletic, some are more modern, some are a hybrid, some are less dancey. That's D-A-N-C-E-Y, dancey.
Yes, yeah, okay, all right. Also, what is dance? Ellipsis question mark. I'm going to leave it at that.
Okay, one final question before we move okay. on.
All right.
I understand that live music is essential to Mark in both the rehearsal, creation, and performance process. Colin, how has your role changed in the creation process now that everything is online?
It's changed quite a bit. Obviously, for the two previous films, video dances that we watched, I was playing the piano. Obviously, that wasn't live, so I had to record myself both video and audio. And then obviously with the Ravel, had to record myself once and then listen to myself in a hidden AirPod in my left ear and play the second part and match that up, which took more times than I'd like to admit to get successful, even though I was accompanying and performing with myself and made incredibly wonderful decisions the first time around musically. But so that's definitely changed in that my performances with the dancers all have to be recorded, and that brings along a different scrutiny and mindset. And then obviously taking on the role as a film editor for these is totally different. I've never done anything like that before. I've done audio editing, but I'd never done any video editing. Even iMovie I hadn't even used before. So learning how to use that. And but it's been thrilling to learn a new skill, and then really fun, you know, the sessions with Mark and Sam where we're actually editing in real time have been really a totally new experience, not something I obviously ever thought we'd be doing a few months ago. But it's been fun to learn a new skill, and it's been fun to use the creative energy that I have pent up, hopefully for good.
And you're also so crazy in your sequestration that you learned how to tune your own damn piano. I think that's incredible. And I salute you.
Thank you. I assume we'll have a facial hair section later in this, or?
Yeah, that's later.
I assume that's really where we're getting building towards. So.
I shall now tell you about the dance that we're going to see in a minute. It's a piece that we're calling Lonely Tango. It's because it's a tango and it's lonely. The music is nice. A section called the Tango Perpetuel, which is part of a piece by Erik Satie called Sport et Divertissement. And I choreographed a dance that was premiered in the before times called Sport.
Before times is in last summer.
And one piece is this tango that is meant to go on forever, which is very irritating and very interesting. So I took that music, a completely different dance film, and gave these assignments. And Colin, what about the music? Something else about the music, have you?
Yeah, no, the music is very interesting in that the direction from Mr. Satie is that it can repeat as many times as you want. There's no, you can be once, it can be 72 times. And that the music is supposed to be banal and annoying. There's no fluctuation. It's pianissimo the whole time. It's supposed to be just very placid, just very straight ahead. No fluctuation of dynamic or tempi. And so it's sort of, it's supposed to be weird and annoying. And I think it is. And we'll see if the video dance mimics Mr. Satie's instructions.
Well, you know, I find almost all contemporary popular music boring and annoying, but that's just me. I'm sorry. I don't want to lead the witness. Let's watch this dance, Lonely Tango. Roll it.
Thank you. Ho. Good. Anyhow, I have to tell you, everybody watching this, including us, is seeing something we've never seen before, including the 75 hours of rehearsal we did. So, you know, those are the exigencies and the madness of this medium and this time. But I don't know what you saw. I saw what I needed to. And I can tell you it's on purpose. I violated one of the most important rules of the theater, which is no animals or children should be seen on stage unless you want everyone to like just ooh and ah and adore everything you did. It's like playing the national anthem. Anyway, also I wanted to say that the dancers who contributed to this in every big way, and fabulous Sam Black, who's my assistant, put this together. They haven't seen any sneak previews of this. So they're either plotting or quelling, depending on who they are. And that's it. What do we have to say? Nancy, some questions?
Sure. One of the questions that's been asked quite a bit is what do the dancers think about working in this new way? Any idea?
I would say that they're glad to be dancing, and it's as close as we can get to being in the same room together. So my encouragement, irritation, brilliant ideas, crappy ideas, their contributions, their personalities, it's a big mix of things. And I would say that most people have a little bit of cabin fever, and they're glad to be doing something that relates to what they normally do. Everyone does class all the time. They're teaching, they're doing what they can, but it's very limited. So I think just the actual eye-to-eye contact and the working on the same thing together is, I believe, very beneficial and really kind of wonderful and enjoyable for the most part. I don't know. That's what I'm guessing.
Actually, the most asked question, which I can no longer avoid, is why are there different figurines or pieces of art in the background of Mark Morris in every segment? Do they have special meaning? The set changes.
They relate to the piece. Yes. Listen, I've been working on that a lot. There are lots you can't see for various reasons. But this is what I chose. And here's why. Because I'm prefiguring the dance you're about to see. So this one,
my God,
is because the next dance, which we're not going to show yet, but pretty soon, is called Sunshine. So it's a moon. It's as close as I could get. Anyway, so they're meant to secretly tell you what's coming up. It's prefiguring in film. That's what we call it.
They're Easter eggs.
Yeah, yeah, whatever that is. Yeah, that's right. Another question?
Okay. What have you learned from the process of choreographing in this manner that you may use when you're able to work on the stage again?
I think I won't chase people around so much, because all they have to do in this medium is just leave the frame and then I don't know where they are. So that'll be a little bit better. I won't be so exhausted. They won't feel so threatened. But it's weird because even though we're all together in these meetings and stuff, it's all individuals. And that's something that's always true. But when you're working with a group of people, you tend to think of them as a group of people. So this sounds fake philosophical, but it's really something I've gotten, that just seeing people one by one, even though they're in tiles, we're thinking rectangularly, they're still them, but they don't have anything to play off of, which you would in a room full of people. So I think just that, I think group versus individual is a very interesting thing. And plus, you know, framing stuff for film, which I've done before, but not in this exact way, is always an interesting point of view, even if you're working in three, four-dimensional space. Did that sound true? I meant it to sound like it was true. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
I bought
it. Another related question.
Yeah.
Another related question is, how did your experience working on the Bach film, the Bach cello suite film with Yo-Yo Ma, and the other films of your work, Dido and Aeneas, The Hard Nut, and others, how did that prepare you for this project?
Entirely. Well, let's not forget my television debut. I choreographed a very early, has some liquid in it. I choreographed that. It was the most fun ever. Well, that's when I learned, especially the piece I did with Yo-Yo, Falling Downstairs, was choreographed specifically for camera and not an adaptation of a stage dance. It was the opposite. We choreographed it. If you don't see it in the film, it didn't exist. And we worked on a 360-degree, you know, rotating camera rolling around, and there was no real front like there is in a theater or like this. It was open. And so I got to experiment with camera action, you know, in how to do cut, you know, all the sort of filmy stuff. And then I thought it was gonna be very hard to convert it into a stage dance, but I just kind of said everybody face that way. It was very easy. So that, in working with that, and that was actual film, that was pre-digital. Other things I've adapted from stage dances to film, and I always have a little bit of a feeling that we're missing something. But if you do everything as a wide shot, it just looks like an ant farm. So you have to make directorial, editorial decisions to show what you want to be highlighted. That's the answer to that.
I'll also just throw in that the sorry, Nancy, didn't mean to interrupt. The last shot that we all saw of the, not the last shot during the credits, but the final shot of Lonely Tango of Mark was the very first video created for that dance and was sort of meant to be the inspiration for the dancers. Mark had thought about doing this, and he and I had talked, and he was playing with being his own director and filming himself, and filmed that, and we thought that was great. And that was sort of the bud that then grew into the Lonely Tango.
And that's why it's black and white, because what's bleaker, you know, it's kind of nice. Anything else, Nancy?
Yes, I wanted, okay. People want to know, Colin, in The Lonely Tango, did you complete the video editing before the recording? How did those come together? What was the timing of those?
No, I did the recording first, and I recorded myself three times through and sent it to the dancers, because Mark's directions for that were to do something for the first half, the A section, for the second half, for the B section. Some people did them separately. Some people did a full take of the whole thing. And so I did it three times through A, B, A, B, A, B, sent that to the dancers, again, because they have to have something to work with that works with our timing. So we can't just listen to a recording on Spotify. So sent that to them and then edited it afterwards. That one is a little more audio edited. We played with it. Mark had some specific opinions, as did I, about how to make it a little weirder, a little drier. And so that's a little more mixed than some of the others to go along with the quality of the black and white. But the audio came first, and then all the video came in, and then we pieced it together. When the video came in, we had not decided, other than Mark's specification that he wanted it to be long, and repeated many times. We didn't know how many times. The first draft that I sent, I think, had two full less times, maybe one or two, I'm not sure, than what ended up in the final product.
So then just
so we weren't sure how long it was going to be until the material came in. Sorry.
So just to clarify, neither of you were actually involved in their filming in real time.
Aside from me candidly shooting myself with my phone, no, everybody did it on their own. And it's crazy. We have a lot of stuff. A lot of it is very, very interesting and not necessarily blackmailable, but there's some crazy, wonderful stuff. Anyway, can't use everything.
I have things backed up. I have things backed up. Don't worry. We're good.
Okay.
So just so you know, that the Tango had 77 different video submissions from the 18 members of the Mark Morris Dance Group.
And will there be a blooper reel, we're being asked?
No comment.
Another question about filming. Were there cameramen? Were these
Wait a minute, wait a minute. Just a second, Nancy. That was the blooper reel. Okay, sorry, go ahead.
It's not a question of if, it's a question of when, and it's a question of who will get to see it.
That's right. Okay, sorry. Go ahead, Nancy, please.
There's a question about how these were filmed. Were they self-filmed? Did the dancers have cameramen, camera people? What do you know about that?
They're called cinematographers. Actually, they're just called anybody with a cell phone. Many people are blessed or cursed with being quarantined with a mate or a something, a roommate or a spouse or whatever. So that builds in a little bit of something, the capacity, if they're not also working at the same time in their palatial Manhattan apartment, their Brooklyn apartment. So everybody, most people film themselves, I think. That's what it seems like. And, you know, some of the stuff, there's like exteriors, there's, you know, beauty shots, as we call them in film. Some beauty shots that don't have anybody in them, that's obviously somebody shot it. And I don't necessarily know who. I kind of don't want to. I like the mystery of that. But yeah, I think it's mostly auto-filmed.
Okay, we have someone asking why you waited so long to work with Ravel's music, having read that this was your first work to Ravel's
work. Interesting. I thought I didn't like Ravel enough. Oops, I'm sorry. I guess I'm just so damn sick of that bolero. Come on already. It's a fabulous piece, but I've heard it way too many times. And I'm still scarred from seeing Béjart's choreography, but you know, I was young. Ravel, I like, you know, people do the Ravel Debussy thing. I'm in the Debussy camp. And Ravel wrote great stuff. I find it usually a little bit too milky. Although I read a fabulous biography of him that made me want to love it even more. I know I said milky. You have to use your.
I know. I was going to let it go. I made a face, yeah. And then that okay. Was enough. But
I can. Yeah. I can see you. I can see you.
We'll talk about that later.
Milky. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. Thanks. I'm going to go on now. Thanks.
Yeah. I'm not.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. So anyhow, the interesting thing about the Ravel is that I don't like the orchestra version. To me, there are too many tassels and fringes and whatever. And it's a dance of balancing that I don't like, so sue me. But I so much prefer the sort of mathematical weirdness and the cacophony, especially today, of the piano arrangement. He did it himself, Ravel did it himself. It's not a reduction just like that, but it is his piece, and it's a big mess of a piece of music. And to me, it sounds more violent and more upsetting in a two piano version. Doesn't mean I'll never do Ravel again. I love a lot of the music. It's just the first time I got to it.
A question about another composer. Have you ever considered working with the great Tom Addis?
Ah, the great Tom Addis. Tom is name drop. A friend of mine. I love his music. Gets a little shrill for me sometimes. But, you know, we've talked about working together. I love specifically those mazurkas, that the impossible to play piano mazurkas that he wrote for Manny Axe. They're incredible. And also this piece, Totentanz, that's relatively recent, that's a beautiful, it was written to be danced to. It was written, I like to think I could have done it. But it's a piece for like the world's biggest orchestra and two singers. So if you're going to do a dance to that, you know, you'd have to have the Arena di Verona to perform it in. It's gigantic. But I stay in touch with him. I'm a very, very big admirer of his music. I think he's a fabulous composer, conductor, pianist. There are no flies on Tom. I love what he does. We'll see.
A question to both of you. What did you like most about working in Zoom?
The incredible audio quality.
I almost shut off my camera there. Yeah, it's hard. What do we like the most? The question was a positive question, not a negative question.
Right, I know. I didn't mean to go negative there, yes. Well, potentially the ability to shut off your camera if you don't like what the other person says is very satisfying. Yeah.
But the stuff I like, I can change my set. Change the set, virtual background, all the magic tricks that don't help at all when you're trying to make up a dance. Go ahead, Colin.
I would say two things. It's as cheesy as it sounds, and this is going to sound cheesy. It's just really nice to see everybody sometimes. You know, we're all used to seeing each other regularly, like every day. You know, so much so after a while, it's nice to not see each other probably, but it's just nice. As strange as it is, even with 20 boxes across your screen, it's nice to be together, since this is what being together entails. And then to get to see people move and get to see people's feedback and have, you know, it does give us as close to a sense of normalcy as we can hope to have when we're all at home. So that is a positive thing.
What I say, and it's become hackneyed, but it's I find it true, is that people talk a lot on television, oh my God, don't start. But the idea that your life is on hold, that you're waiting to come back to your life. And I'm sorry, everybody, this is your life. It actually is your life happening right now in this form. So it's like, oh, if only I could. Well, you can't. You will be able to in some way soon. And this is what we're doing now. This is how we're living. And there's no real reason to fight it.
Okay, due to popular demand, I think you both need to make some sort of comment about the facial hair. The Q&A box is overflowing.
What, they're not watching the dances? This is not about my, okay. Facial hair.
It's only about the facial hair, Mark. Come on, that's why you wanted to do this.
For me, with facial hair, it's not a design decision. It's a decision made through apathy. So it's not an action, it's the lack of an action. If you don't shave, and some people, if you don't shave, you get a beard. Nothing, you don't have to do anything fabulous or surprising. And I was gonna go all Colonel Sanders for this, but I didn't wanna compete with Colin's facial array. So this is what and this is trimmed. I looked, you know, it was really spherical before. Colin hair?
Yes, my beard trimmer died, and when this all began,
oh, I'm sorry, you must have been heartbroken.
It was. I worked through it. It's still a process. Thanks. I appreciate some space. And so, a few days after this started, I was getting enough hair, and I shaved. And of course, like anyone does, whether they admit it or not, you shave in phases, and you leave a goatee or you know Van Dyke, and then you know you always end with a mustache, and it always looks ridiculous. And I kept it, and my wife and daughter were like, oh yeah, it's kind of fun. And it didn't look ridiculous. So instead of keeping it for 10 minutes, I kept it for a few days. And then here we are 11 weeks later.
Okay.
Well, your family is very kind.
A quick question before we move on. What is your go-to wine, Mark, during quarantine?
Chateau Plance, what is that? That's a Pomerol, a fabulous Pomerol. Although tonight I celebrated, I bought a very nice, something else. Oh no, I bought a Pouligny Montrachet for the white version. So nice, and I have liquor stores are essential, and I have one across the street, so I'm essentialized. I wanna say something, that's the last question, Nancy. Can I introduce the next number?
Yes, please.
Okay, I shall. This next number is a real crowd pleaser. And the reason it is that is because anybody could do it. The instructions for the dance happen in the very first part of this video dance. And I want to tell you, it's based on three forms of locomotion. One is stepping, the second is walking, and the third is running and hopping. So it starts very basically, it matches the rhythm of the piece of music, which in this case is You Are My Sunshine, as performed by the great singing cowboy, Gene Autry. I started choreographing this piece of music 30 years ago as sort of a tribute to the great geniuses of Judson Church and the early sort of minimalist pedestrian kind of dancing. I was using popular music with just walking and running and whatever. And finally, this dance was realized. I'd been working on it a few months ago because I do periodically, and now it exists in a form that I never imagined that it would. So you can learn this dance. It's a real earworm too, this piece of music, and you'll be able to do it on your own with no supervision. It's not dangerous in any way. So before we roll this, I wanna say thank you very much. I can't tell you how grateful I am to be able to do this with my colleagues and all of you people watching, and we're vamping it as you are. So enjoy this. This is called Sunshine. Roll it.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. You are my left, right, my make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away. The other night, dear, as I lay sleeping, I dreamed I held you in my arms. When I awoke, dear, I was mistaken, and I hung my head and cried. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away. I'll always love you and make you happy if you will only say the same. But if you leave me to love another, you'll regret it all someday. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away. You told me once, dear, you really love me, and no one else, dear, could come between. But now you've left me and love another. You have shattered all my dreams. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Okay, well, before we go, I do want to let everybody know that this will be available on YouTube, so you will be able to see Lonely Waltz again without the choppiness. That's on the Mark Morris Transcript YouTube channel. And I thought before we go, perhaps you gentlemen could share with us a little bit about the listening sessions that you'll be doing this summer. Okay, thank you for listening.
Oh. We're doing list, which means, huh?
You want to answer that or shall I?
I do, but it cut me off, so that's why I stopped talking.
I like the set change, by the way.
Thank you. Done? Okay. We're doing listening sessions where Colin and I, obviously, we have a relationship of some sort, which is pretty good and kind of interesting to us, will be... thematic. We're doing probably something on difficult to listen to modern music that people think they don't like, but it's actually fabulous. Maybe film music. We're not certain exactly of all of them, but it'll be groups of people and we'll listen to music together and talk about it in various, you know, analytical and emotional ways. I think that's what it'll be.
Right. So stand by, everyone. We will get you those dates. We'll announce that. Stay tuned for more other live streams and other events this coming summer. And I do ask that once we sign off, that you stay and watch the credits. There are a list of many of our major supporters without whom we would not continue to exist. So thank you. Thank you for joining us tonight.
Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.
There's always tomorrow to bring us a smile. Maybe we should borrow that font for a while. For when we both remember To capture